You know, Melvin Van Peebles, that's my real name. It's on my birth certificate. It's not some Soviet name that I came up with.
That's the canal. It leads into the thing.
We spent a lot of time by the canal. Looking at the universe. What was the best way to help my folks? That's what it was all about. That's what I was thinking. And trying to figure out just how to get the man's foot out of my ass. How was I gonna make him eat shit? What would be the best way? And then suddenly, one day, I figured it out. What I was going to do. Just like a damn duck making it over the barrier. Just do it. You see, after Watermelon Man, I had a chance. Just a little bitty chance, but for us colored folks, a little bitty chance is a whole lot of chance. Those are good odds for ghetto folks. The only problem was I couldn't remember my plan. You know, all of that glamour and all that stuff floating around, three-picture deal with Columbia Films and, you know, the cigar. What was my idea? How was I gonna do the deal? Well, I didn't have a whole lot of time. So I figured out, I better figure it out. And I heard an electric shock and all that other stuff. So I had to use a poor man's electric shock. I used what I call semen shock. I had to find some bait to do the shock. So I went to find myself, it wasn't here, but it was like this. It was in the desert. I went to find myself that place. Sweetback. Sweetback. Yep.
Sweet, Sweetback's badass song.
You know, since I had the advantage of being self-taught, I didn't know I couldn't do it. You know, like a bumblebee doesn't know he's aerodynamically unsound and he can't fly, but he doesn't know that, so he flies anyway. I shot the film in 19 days, but it actually turned out to be 40 days or something like that. We were working very, 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 very long hours. And I remember the director of photography. What I loved about this guy, he could hang for 20 hours, just like I could. And when the rest of the people were caving in, he could still manage to hang in there.
I remember the very first day of shooting, I asked the director of photography for a certain light, and he said he couldn't do that.
You can't mix those two lights because the result is whatever. I said, we'll do it anyhow. And he did it. Then when he saw the rushes, he was overjoyed. And I never had a bit of trouble with him after that. One of the things, maybe it seems a little thing, but it was a big thing. And that was the stuntman. I couldn't afford a stuntman, so I was the stuntman. And I remember once I had to jump off this bridge. And I jumped off the bridge one time. And the director of photography was also the head cameraman, he said, "Well, that's great, Mel, but let's do it again." And so I did it again. And I said, "How was that, Bob?" His name is Bob Maxwell. And he says, "That was okay, but long story short, I had to jump off this damn thing because I didn't want to jump off in the first place 9 times. He was very apologetic about the 7th time. I began to laugh. He asked me why I was laughing.
Fucking showbiz. It's a living, what can I tell you?
Since I was a stuntman and since I had every penny I had in the film, I had no choice. Actually, I had no idea of being the lead in the film, but the actors who had enough experience wouldn't do the film unless they had more lines. Sweetback only said 6 lines in the whole film. And everybody kept saying, "Well, I might do it, I might consider it if I had more lines, since you're not paying me very much." But I didn't want him to talk a lot. So that's how I ended up doing it myself. Speaking of being able to pay, people now proclaim many times that I'm a financial wizard to keep all control of Sweetback. I own everything. I wasn't a financial wizard. I begged everybody in the world to come in with me, but no one would. Bill Cosby, though, he loaned me $50,000 to finish the film. But he didn't want an equity part. He just wanted his money back. And I think he never expected to see it. And when I paid him back, he wouldn't even take any interest on his money. He really helped me out. I remember when I was in deep, deep trouble one time, I was explaining to my girlfriend how much trouble I was in. And then a couple days later, I explained to her that I was out of trouble. Well, that's very relative speaking. And she said that she never had any doubt. It made me feel so proud that she believed in this black man who was going to do it. I said, "How did you know that, honey?" She said, "Well, because you're a Leo, and that means your such and such is in the right house or the conjunction of the such and such." And I got pissed off. And I threw her out. I was running short on girlfriends, but I still threw her out. Also, by the very nature of the film, I wasn't that short on girlfriends. In fact, when I was shooting Sweetback, I caught my one and only case of clap, gonorrhea. I suppose it was my fault because the actor said, "Well, don't." And I said, "I'm the director, I know what I'm doing." Well, 3 days later, when I went to take a leak, I realized I didn't know what I was doing. However, if somebody gives you lemon, you can make lemonade out of it. I applied to the Directors Guild for compensation because I got hurt on the job. And they were so surprised that they paid me. And so I used the money to buy more film. Yeah. There are 1,000 stories I could tell you, but I don't think I will. And I'll answer you right now. One thing, I'm not going to say which actress gave me the clap. I may be a cad, but I'm not indiscreet. Another thing is, I'm not gonna say what that lizard tastes like that I ate in the desert. However, if you had eaten some of these fast food joints on Sunset Boulevard, it's good training. It's good training. Since it was a very dangerous thing that I was doing, trying to make a film without the unions, I was armed. as were my key people. We all had guns. And one day, I went to look for my gun, and I asked, there really was a gopher, it was the first time one was on the film, and I asked her where my gun was. She said, oh, I put it in the prop box. The prop box! And the day before, we had shot the film with Beetle. And luckily, and no one had picked up the real gun. This poor guy would have got his brain blown out. Well, it was a close call, but there were a lot of close calls like that. I would shoot the film in what I call globs. I'd shoot one whole sequence at a time. Because with amateurs, which most of my actors were, I'd come back the next day with the different clothes or something like that, or a haircut. But if I shot the entire thing that I wanted him for, I never had to worry about that problem. Did have a problem one time though, in the motorcycle scene, these sort of Hell's Angels, after they had been paid for a certain amount of time, the guy said, we want to leave. I said, you were paid until the scene was over. And the guy, he said, well, I want to, we want to leave. And he took out a knife and started tuning his fingernails. And I snapped my fingers, and my guy was standing up there with rifles. And so they stayed, and that's how we shot that scene. How I got the fire department was I got a permit, but I did the permit so to explode the car. But I did it on Friday, so they wouldn't have time to put it in. And when I exploded the car, the fire truck showed up. So I had a fire truck in the scene. But I had my permit, so they had to let me go. As I was going to the desert, I saw this truck going along with these big tubes. And I cut it off in my car and said to the guy, I'll give you $10 if you let me sit in the tube for a couple of miles. And so we shot that sequence.
From the very beginning, back in 1957, people were always commenting on my film being a little weird, the subject matter and the angles I used and the superimpositions and things like that. Me, I figure that came from the fact that I was self-taught amidst the technological colonization of the white aesthetic. Anyhow, back then everybody just thought I was crazy. Another little problem was I couldn't and still can't read or write music. And I had no money, so I couldn't afford musicians to do the soundtrack. So I had to do it myself. I couldn't even really play harmonica, and I wasn't even that good at humming. So I numbered all the keys on the piano, and that way I could remember the melody. Didn't matter all that much back then.
Of course, the music for a film was not thought much of at that time. And now, of course, it's de rigueur, the album. But I had no money by the time the film was finished and no way of advertising. So I said, well, I'll write a hit tune. And then when the DJ played the tune, they'd be advertising the film. It's so logical. And now you say, well, what were people thinking of before? The soundtrack was Earth, Wind, and Fire's first album. They were living along in Hollywood Boulevard, all in sort of one apartment, and sort of starving to death. And the way I ran into them was a secretary of mine was going with one of the bands. She told me about this group. I went to see them and talk to them. They're really very, very nice guys. And even since they didn't know anything about cinema either, they didn't know enough to say I was nuts. And so I wrote the music, and then I projected the film and had them play with it, just like you'd have a big symphony orchestra. I went to a company called Stax. It was a black company. And they were so successful with it until they were asked to oversee the music for Shaft, which really went through the roof. And that really changed everything.
That reminds me of my most infamous scene. Critics are always mumbling about the meaning and praising the symbolism of it. I'll take the credit, of course, but all that rites of passage praise was an afterthought, really. The critics keep giving me credit for this scene as a well-thought-out metaphor. A tableau of the rites of passage. That wasn't what happened. The truth of the matter, the real deal, the truth of the matter is, the real deal is I was just being my horny self. My son, Mario, was playing Sweetback as a kid. It's a little complicated. I'm going to work on the recreation part now. I'm going to try and recreate what happened.
You know, Marshall McLuhan said that the medium is the message. And following that rule, I decided that I would shoot this not in the grandiose style that I can now afford, but in the same style that I shot Sweetback originally. Unfortunately, when you're doing things inexpensively, you run into trouble. And it happened again.
The so-called actors had a fight with a boyfriend and couldn't make it.
But there is a guy, and the receptionist overheard us, and she offered to do the scene as long as we didn't show her face.
Entree, s'il vous plaît.
Mario, he gets up and leaves. And you got this beautiful woman laying there, and to tell the truth, a little hot and bothered.
And there was still filming the camera.
What the hell, I'm only human. I'm not sure exactly how it happened, but you get the idea. So I go to get up. And then I remember the cap, and I saw the cap. And I got my cap that I had loaned my son, and I put it on. In other words, the boy gets down and the man gets up. And voila, cinema history. Once I began to make money, that film made a huge amount of money. Independent films were taken seriously.
My favorite man. America being fixated on the racial thing.
And I'm called the godfather of black movies. The truth of the matter is I'm the godfather of independent film, the Blair Witch Project too. Sweetback was actually a trilogy. I have two other parts that I've never shot because when I was doing the film, I promised white folks two for one. I promised they could feel liberal by helping me and having their racist theory vindicated by my failure.
Man wasn't too fond of a black guy succeeding on his own. When the film was a hit, the shit hit the fan.
Everybody got pissed off and felt cheated. And since that time, I've never had an offer to do anything. I've had to do it like I always did, myself. I don't really mind. It's been very, very interesting. In fact, I shouldn't put it in the past tense. It still is.
Faith in Beale, old Beale gonna bring you through. Of course, this is just a skirmish. You know how the damn game go, baby. But you keep the faith in me, and you my man. You my favorite man. Can you take it, baby?
I don't know where to sleep back here.
Come on, boy, talk!
Yes, the good thing, fairy godmother. Why, didn't you know that all good dakes had fairy godmothers?
Every dollar we make, the Guineas get 20, the police get 40, and Goldberg's get 50. Anybody can tell you that don't add up to a dollar. That adds up to a dollar and a dab.
No, I haven't seen him, Sweetback.
I haven't seen the cat. I mean, I don't want to see him. You just keep leaning and leaning and leaning. Get the f*** off of my back, man! I'm clean, man. Look, I'm clean. There's nothing there. Look, look! When I get pissed off, man, I will throw a nacho bone nigger fit on you, understand? Leave! Split! Leave, mother!
Good news to me, slapping up on some white cops. Yes, indeed. I'm gonna say a black Ave Maria for you.
Folks will tell you to live one way. Just watch. They'll go live another. Don't try to follow what everybody's got to say. Because most free advice ain't good for nothing except turning you gray.
I would do something if I didn't mind making myself common. I'd thrash and drop pop.
Harold, get our things.
Paris, I suppose.
Because you're the captain's new good colored boy. You're the captain's Uncle Tom, baby.
Mm-hmm.